All right, so we begin with FFT. FFT is fast Fourier transform. Fast Fourier transform. This is not a new transform. It is simply an algorithm to evaluate DFT. That's it. So it's not a new transform, like discrete Fourier transform is a new transform. You have DTFT also, you have CTFT, all these are transforms, but FFT is not a transform. It is merely an algorithm to perform discrete Fourier transform. Why do you need it? Is the question that requires an answer. Well, the layman answer is that faster computation. Is possible using FFT. Now the question is how much faster, and how can we say that the computations are faster? That means that when you give a sequence xn and you evaluate DFT to get xk. So I'm saying if you apply conventional method, let this DFT be endpoint. If you apply conventional method, suppose you take time t1 to evaluate it, and you apply FFT. And you take time t2, you know, to get it. And let's say that the total number of computations are c1, and here the total number of computations are c2. So the idea is that t2 is much, much less than t1. So that means it's very fast, and the number of computations c2 are much, much less than C1. Let's, you know, look into it from a mathematical point of view. So it's obvious that if a computer is performing less number of calculations or manipulations, the time to come to the result is going to be much smaller. So if we can prove this, then this automatically follows. This will automatically follow if we can prove this. Okay, so let's do that. Suppose I take xn with 8 samples. Okay, so if I evaluate its xk, then according to the standard convention, n will vary from 0 to 7. You will have xn w8 kn, and k will vary from 0 to 7, right? So if I expand this, this becomes x0 w80 plus x1 w8 to the power k plus x2 w8 to the power 2k plus x3 w8 to the power 3k plus x4 w8 to the power 4k plus x5 w8 to the power 5k plus x6 w8 to the power 6k and w7 W 8 to the power of
unknown caller
7k. Right. So if you look at it, then you have one product, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, and 8. Sorry. So these products are essentially products between two complex quantities. You know, in general, the samples of xn will be complex, and of course the Tweedle factor components are going to be complex. So basically, for a xn with 8 samples, you're evaluating a DFT which will have 8 complex multiplications. And if you look at additions, then you have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and 7. And you have 7 additions, right? So I can say that if you're evaluating a 8-point DFT, if you're evaluating a 8-point DFT, for each K, you have 8 complex multiplications, and let me just write it as 8 minus 1 complex additions, because obviously when you multiply two complex numbers, you will end up with a complex number most of the times. So we assume that they generally, there are 8 complex multiplications and 8 minus 1, which is 7 complex additions. So if suppose instead of 8 point DFT, if n point DFT is evaluated, if n point DFT is evaluated, then for every value of k, you will require n complex multiplications, and you will require n minus 1 complex additions. Now, since K also has n values, and these values vary from 0 to n minus 1, so total complex multiplications they become n square. This n multiplied by the number of complex multiplications in one, one for 1k n. So for n k's, n square. Then complex additions that are required is going to be simply n times n minus 1. Because for every k, you require n minus 1 complex additions. So if k takes n values, then the total number of complex additions will be n times n minus 1. Now, just a second. Yeah. Now, one complex multiplication is requiring 4 real multiplications. And it requires 2 real additions. We'll see how. Suppose I have 2 complex numbers that I multiply. So I can write this as ax plus j y a plus j b x minus b y. So this becomes ax minus b y plus j y a plus b x. So you can see that I have one product, two products, three and four. So there are four real multiplications, because a, b, x and y are all real numbers. So there are four real multiplications, and then there are two real additions. Subtraction is also, you know, considered as an addition of, you know, a negative quantity. So you have two additions. This addition is not really a manipulation, not a valid arithmetic operation, because once these two additions are done, they are simply going to be stored somewhere in the memory of a computer, and when this complex number has to be, you know, formulated, then they will retrieve the real part and they will read the imaginary part. So, you know, that is what will constitute a complex number. So this is not a addition per se, it just, this entire thing represents one complex number. So actually there are only two real additions. So for one complex multiplication, you have four real multiplications and two real additions. For one complex addition between two complex numbers, as I mentioned before, you require two real additions. Okay, so basically you have a plus jb plus x plus jy. So that is basically a plus x plus j, b plus y. So you have one addition and you have another addition. So that is what it is. So one complex multiplication is four real multiplications and two real additions. One complex addition is two real additions. That means total real multiplications are going to be basically 4n square, because if you remember, we had complex multiplications were n square. So one complex multiplication requires four real multiplications. So n square complex multiplications will require 4n square real multiplications. Total real additions total real additions are going to be, you have n into n minus 1 complex additions, right? So and one complex addition is two real additions, so n minus 1 into n complex additions is going to be 2 into n minus 1 complex real additions, I'm sorry, plus in complex multiplication you have two real additions. That means for n square you will have 2n square real additions. So these are the total number of real multiplications that will happen, and this represents the number of total real additions. Now you can, you know, calculate these values. If you take n to be 256, that is a very normal, it's a very small value for n when you're evaluating DFTs using a computer, and you will see that the total number of calculations which will be, or the arithmetic operations that need to be performed, will roughly be of a tune of somewhere around 573,000 some hundred. So this is in lakhs. So many operations, and that's a huge number, no doubt, right? Generally, typically, when you're using computers to evaluate DFT, generally n is of a magnitude of somewhere about 2 to the power 10. Okay, minimum. Generally, it's considered to be greater than that, taken to be greater than that. But let's say that we take 2 to the power 10, then this total number of manipulations, you know, 4n square plus 2n square, 2n, n minus 1 will be in millions. really, really huge number, millions, some number of, you know, millions. So obviously, you know, that is not a practical solution when you have to evaluate DFTs. Just for comparison, let me tell you what will happen if you are doing FFT. In FFT, real multiplications are simply 2n log n to the base 2. That's it. These are the number of real multiplications that you're performing. Real additions that you're actually performing. Now, these numbers, these expressions that I'm writing, of course, we'll you know, evaluate them, but just to get a perspective, I'm telling you that, you know, that the number of real additions are 3n log n to the base 2. So for, you know, n to be equal to 256, you will see that these values that come out are significantly less than the values that you would actually require to do the calculation using a conventional DFT. So they come out in some thousands, the total calculations, total let's say evaluations, which means the sum of multiplications and additions, somewhere in thousands. Okay, so you get something tens and thousands. So obviously this number is much, much lesser. So you know, there I prove the fact that C2 is much, much less than C1. That means number of evaluations in FFT are far less than the number of evaluations in DFT, and obviously that means that the time taken to evaluate DFT using FFT is much less than evaluating DFT in the conventional sense using the conventional formula. Alright, so this is the justification of why we use FFT to evaluate DFT. Of course, layman will say just faster, but as an engineer, I think probably this conceptual understanding of why it's going to be faster is very important, and I've just given you some formulas and the right perspective to, you know, put this into your, you know, brain once and for all that FFT is faster. This is the reason why FFT is faster. All right. So that's it. This is the end of this lecture. Thank you.